beer, rum, and rock and roll. Saving rock, one conversation at a time. With Randy Legault and Beau Shiminsky.
Well, that was the Central Scrutinizer.
Yes.
Hey?
You know that one? Heard it a few times, have you?
I know him. We'll get back to him later.
Sure. Okay. Sounds good.
I missed you, man. It's been a while since we've been at the table. Hey?
Yeah. It's good to be home.
Yeah.
It's good to be here. I missed it.
Judging by the amount of views the last one got when I went by myself, the people have spoken. They would rather it was the two of us.
Well, that's nice to know. Thank you.
That's not as easy as it looks. Talking to you is not talking to a camera. Like, I laugh at my own jokes all the time, so that's not a problem. But it was more difficult than people realize.
I knew it was going to be, and that's why I didn't even talk to you about it pre-post
right.
podcast.
No pep talk.
Yeah. I didn't know how it was going to go, but I know right. It's got to be difficult.
And I did enjoy it. For
did
what
you?
It was, but I'd rather talk to you, obviously, than talk to myself I'm not really talking to myself. You got to think of the audience, but it's just your own voice the entire time. I mean, I love the sound of my own voice, but that's overkill, dude.
Well, yeah, I was feeling for you in the moment, but you know, the show checked out. It's all good. You know, you did it. Thank you for doing
that. Hey, man.
Yeah. I wish I could have been here, but it was just a little too difficult, but we're here now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've got one piece of, let's call it viewer mail. Let's give Letterman a nod.
Okay.
Let's go to viewer mail. It was on Instagram, and I'm going to read it to you.
Set it
I'm
up.
Pretty sure it's more directed at me than you. I would bet money on it.
Right.
Okay. So here goes. Ready?
Okay.
And it's not all negative, by the way. It's
I know what it is now. You know, I know what it is now. Yeah.
I found my way to your show via Spotify. I love the concept. And listen, because of the Dirt review. So he's listening
Motley
to
guy.
Our Motley
yeah, sure.
review.
Yeah.
Massive Crew fan, 80s kid, great conversation. But the use of the F word, every other sentence started getting old fast. What the fuck's he talking about?
See.
Hang on, man. Just
okay,
let me go to the end and you can go.
Yeah, sure.
Sure. I'm far from religious and I'm no prude and I'm not offended by everything. Millennials in brackets. But it just became so frequent that it was hard to finish the episodes. Hey, I'm just here to help. Only my opinion, and yes, I found Generation Swine hard to listen to, blah, blah, blah. All the best, cheers. Like, he likes the he watched it,
yeah.
So I didn't completely derail it with my F-bombs.
Right.
I have talked about it on the show before, but man, I got to dial down the swear.
Your mom has talked about
my
it.
My mom, yeah, but this isn't my mom. But he likes the show, so I respond. I'm like, thanks for checking out the show. I just said, I don't know why, but I get all fired up and the F, but I don't think about it. They just start flying out of my face. Like it's like a tick or something. I got Tourette's.
Tourette's. Yeah, they have a name for it.
All the best, blah, blah, blah. Then he gets back and he's a trucker from Australia. So we're getting out there, dude.
Hey.
Right?
I think anything to get through those miles, boys, it's all good. Yeah, glad we can help.
Him and all his buddies are into the rock thing like we are. Hmm. And blah, blah, blah. Keep doing the show. Cheers. So he is liking it. But you're just wondering why I swear so fucking much.
Well, I'd have to go listen to the podcast again because I don't know if I ever really notice it. It's just not, it's part of the candor and the flow that
I don't
really feel it.
I don't notice it while I'm doing it.
Yeah, yeah.
But when I listen to the show back, I definitely do.
You did notice.
And this is show number 12, I believe, the Motley Crue one.
Right.
So I was going mental then. I dialed it
so
down.
Fresh.
I dialed it down after that. I think
was that
I did.
Pre or post mom comment? Because that might have said, you know, set the stage a little bit.
Oh man, but I just thought it was funny.
Hey, they're listening.
I don't mind
That's
some critique. Let it come,
sure.
man. We can all improve.
Sure.
Because that is annoying. If you swear that much, it's just like, really, dude? Like, it's like a crutch or some kind of thing, right?
You know what's funny?
It takes the punch out of the word.
Over the years, words don't have that weight to me anymore, you know?
Sure.
It means nothing.
But any word you say over and over and over is going to get on somebody's nerves.
Sure.
That's no matter what it
sure.
is. Right?
Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. One see of what those I'm saying?
Things. See what I'm saying?
Right?
Yeah.
We've all got them.
Yeah. Hey, well, thanks for listening. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, perfect.
Hey, bring it on. I was almost late today. I'm bombing down the road, and I can see a train coming. So I'm fucking giving her. I'm going 100K down this little side road. I'm like, there's no fucking way. I'm going to beat this train.
Okay.
So I went all Dirty Mary, Crazy Larry. I fucking bombed across, and I made it. But just before the lights started going, eh?
Oh, so before anything was moving. Okay.
Barely.
Okay.
Like, I got through, and the lights went on. I'm like...
That sucks, eh? This feels like you just got time of your life ripped from you when you got to sit there and count. Totally. 97, 98, 99. Where's the fucking caboose?
The best is when it rocks and then it rocks backwards, starts going the other way.
Oh, yeah.
That's
been
the
there.
Best.
Been there.
And you're boxed in. You can't even fucking Yui out of it.
Right.
Oh, dude. Anyway, I won. I won that battle.
Good for you, man. Dedication. Yeah. Dedication. I was almost late, too.
Were you?
Yeah. I threw out my back today somehow.
Reaching for the remote?
No. I swear, man, I am at the kitchen sink, standing there minding my own business, watching the dogs outside. I don't even think I moved. All of a sudden, fucking stabbing pain in my right lower back.
That's so weird, right?
And, oh, fuck. And I'm thinking, oh, this will go away. Yeah, no, it never goes away.
Nags.
It just starts to tingle and then get hot. You know what I mean?
That's what happens when you're north of 50, man. This is the things you deal with.
So I've been slow. Yeah, today's been slow moving. You
want to make up a story. I was fucking lifting weights. No, I'm reaching for a kitchen knife in the sink.
Fuck, I was doing nothing, man. I was blinking. I was fucking blinking.
Oh, man. But you're all right now. You got a rum and you're loosening up. You're
I got good. A rum. I got some Tiger Bomb.
Tiger
Bomb on right. it. And rum, yeah, it's all good.
This is our first show of 2021, and I'm gonna be a downer right off the fucking top.
Right.
There's already three
rock
and roll deaths, right?
Yeah.
Tim Bogart, I don't know if you're too familiar with him.
I'm not.
My familiarity with him, I have the album he did with Jeff Beck and Carmine, A Piece.
Okay.
So I've got that album, obviously, because I'm a Jeff Beck freak, so that's how I
what
know
What was
him.
That though? That trio called? Was there a name for them?
No.
It wasn't, eh?
No, it just had their three names on the cover.
That's it. Okay.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
And he was in Vanilla Fudge, who had that big, what's that hit?
That's
Carmine. Keep Me Hanging On.
Deal, yeah, okay, yeah.
And then Bogart formed Cactus. I don't know if you're familiar with them.
Not, no.
With Carmine. They did that,
yeah.
And then he did the Jeff Beck thing.
Gotcha.
He died of cancer at 76, the big C.
Right.
Next up is Sylvain
right.
from the New York Dolls, who most people are into that scene, know who that is, obviously. Mm-hmm. 69 from cancer again. He's an icon.
In that scene that was so short-lived and so big, so massive, especially on your body and your everything. It was just all so crazy.
But he was in that punk doc. That's the last time I saw him interviewed.
Right.
On that.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
He's cool.
Yeah.
He's born in Cairo, Egypt. I thought that was interesting. Didn't know that. And last but not least, Phil Freak Show Spector. Well. Like this guy. I mean, talk about a genius and a nut job.
Yeah.
Like he was in prison for 2003 murder.
That
of,
gun incident. Yeah,
actress Lana Clarkson was her name. But he's famous for the Motown Wall of Sound. So he produced the Ronettes, the Crystals, the Righteous Brothers, the Beatles, Ike and Tina, John Lennon, George Harrison, Leonard Cohen, Ramones. I mean, this guy.
His set of ears were incredible. And then to take it from his ears and present it, which today you listen to that and it's like, wow. You
it's
know,
unreal.
You still.
Oh,
yeah, I know. I was just going to say.
I love that Motown shit.
Me too.
It's just unreal.
Me too.
It still sounds fresh today, man. It just, but he was brilliant, but he was a fucking violent nut job. Did you see that HBO movie where Pacino played him? It came out a few years ago. It's all right. Like, Pacino did a decent job. But by the end, you know, he went to court with that crazy fucking afro and shit. You're like, what's happening? This guy's nuts.
Yeah. How old was he when he died?
He would be 81. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's not like
when you get 80, man. It's like you
don't want to die.
I know you don't want to die, but the world you got to see some years, man. You know
you don't want to die in prison, is what I was saying.
Yeah, but he lived enough before that.
Sure.
Then whatever the balance is still, but yeah.
Okay, dude. Well,
let's move
let's
on
get
to
into
some
it.
sunnier topics, please.
Let's talk about some new music. So. There's just one album I want to touch on that came out the other day. It's by the Dead Daisies. It's called Holy Ground. Now, I don't know how many people are familiar with the Dead Daisies. They've been around a while. like 2013. And they're formed by this dude who I'm not familiar with. His name's David Lowry. So I looked him up, and it looks like he's a guy who's got some bank, and he wanted to start a band, and he's connected with people, and he starts this super group collective thing.
That's where you start. You start with a super group that you're not a superstar in. It's crazy.
Right. He's the least known guy in the band.
100%.
Yeah, exactly.
This is crazy to me.
And people come in and out of the band, and they put out quality shit. So guys that have been in the band, Richard Fortus from GNR, Daryl Jones plays bass for the Stones. He's been in it. Dizzy Reed from GNR, Marco Mendoza from Lizzie and Whitesnake, Brian Tichy, who's drummed for Whitesnake, former
Aussie.
I'm already
tired of counting because I know it gets to close to 20, I think is what the
deal is. And John Corabi,
yeah.
Who, you know, he sang in The Scream and Motley and he does his own thing. He was their main singer for the last three albums. He bolts because he wanted to do his own thing.
Yeah.
And Glenn Hughes stepped in. So the new lineup is Glenn Hughes on bass and vocals, Doug Aldridge from Whitesnake on guitar, Dean Castronovo from Journey on drums. He plays on the album, but now he's gone. And Tommy Clefutos, who filled in for Bill Ward and Sabbath, he's the drummer now. That's okay. All the shit just keeps shifting, right?
Did it happen after the album was released?
Yes, Dean's on the album.
Okay.
Yeah, Tommy's going to be their live guy whenever that fucking happens.
Yeah.
Glenn Hughes, this dude is 69 years old.
I was just
going to
say.
His fucking pipes. It's if you didn't know he was 69, you would have no idea whatsoever. He's a freak of nature.
I'm playing this in my house the other night, and, you know, my daughter, she's not into hard rock or whatever,
yeah.
But when I explained to her that he's going to be 70 this summer.
And he looks great, too, still.
And he's screaming like he does. She couldn't believe it. Like, she just had no idea that this was even something one would even try to do at 70, let alone... Yeah.
It's
he's
freakish.
He's a rock star, so he's not just standing there, you know what I mean?
No.
He's a bass player, so he does both, which is already on another level.
Yeah.
You know, there's not many that command both well. Not many.
You're right, there isn't. Phil Lynott comes to mind. Not
sure.
Not many bass. Yeah, you're right.
Lemmy.
Yep.
But not many, and then to sing like he sings.
It's really crazy, right?
Yeah.
He just sounds amazing. If you like big fucking guitar riffs, and thumping groovy bass, you're gonna like this album. Like, it's just, it rocks. There's only one mellow tune on it, the last one, Far Away. That's it. And Doug Aldridge, the solos are ripping. Like, if you like rock, just basic fucking heavy rock, you're gonna like this. I would be shocked if somebody didn't. It reminds me of Glenn Hughes put out an album called Resonate in 2016, which I have. It reminds me of that.
I think they're pretty happy to get Glenn.
Oh,
especially
fuck.
Kind of where this is in his career.
Yeah.
I mean, how many years do you got left, you know, pushing that shit out like that,
that's
like
right.
The way they do.
Yeah.
You know, this may be the cherry on top that
it could be
really does sound amazing. Did you watch they create a little video before they release the record and
right.
They show them in the studio.
I did not see that.
Okay.
They've got two videos for songs on the album.
Yeah.
I didn't see that, no.
So there's about a 20-minute little pre-promo trailer about this record.
Right.
We'll link to it on,
on
the show.
Yeah, I like those.
They recorded in France.
Right.
They were going to record in Vancouver. But the producer, this guy that produced the last two, I can't remember how many he's done.
Right.
He said, we could get this studio in France. And that's where they ended up going.
France or Vancouver?
Right?
Hmm.
It's in this big house. And what's crazy is, like, there's some really fun, interesting kind of weirdness going on with this little video. Because the drummer you mentioned from Journey.
Dean.
He's like spaz. Like, if you hear him talk, it's like he's just moving all the time. Then you see Glenn at 69. Looking full on rock star.
He's always looks full on rock
full
star.
Full on
hey?
Rock star.
Yeah.
You know, and you can't even explain it in your brain. Like, this is what's happening when you look at your parents, you know?
I know, right? I'm going to be that guy. Yeah.
Totally. I mean, there's lots of little things that are interesting in this little video. So I urge people to watch it if you're into the Dead Daisies. But I did, on the little video, Doug Aldridge was saying that he's suffering from ear damage.
Yeah, I knew that.
Did you? Yeah. And I think this might be it for him. It sounded like
really
the way he said
God,
it.
That would be too bad.
Yeah. Yeah. He looks good. Yep. Plays great.
Yep.
Great riffs.
And he's young. He's in his 50s.
In his 50s. Thank you, sir. Yes.
I want to mention too, they do a cover of Humble Pie's 30 Days in the Hole. I want to mention that.
Right.
And that's really cool. That's, I like that song to begin with. And Dean sings that one. Glenn sings backup on that one.
Ah. What was your favorite track off the record? Did you have one?
Well, again, I only gave it a couple spins.
Yeah.
I like that title track, Holy Ground, I like. And Bustle and Flow, I thought was cool.
Great.
But I don't know the album that well. I just know it's full of great rock stuff. I can tell you that.
Yeah. I do like Bustle and Flow.
Yeah.
I do like the groove of it.
Yeah.
You know, great track. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it's hard rock though. Like it's
refreshing for me, man.
Yeah.
Like, I don't care.
Yeah.
Like nobody's doing this shit
anymore.
No,
exactly.
Okay, now, just like Chris Cornell, I could listen to Jay Buchanan from Rival Sons sing the fucking phone book, and I'm going to like it.
Mm.
So when I saw that he was on this, it's called Greenfield's The Gibb Brothers Songbook Volume 1. That's a long-winded way of saying it's Barry Gibb duets.
Mm-hmm.
It's people duetting with Barry Gibb. That's what it is. So he's on it. He does Jive Talkin' with Miranda Lambert, and he goes solo on To Love Somebody, which is an old Bee Gees tune. And I just love listening to him sing. That's all I got to say. Check it out. Like, I just love this guy's voice and what he brings to a song, man.
To love somebody the way that I love you.
For me, the Bee Gees were so massive.
Yeah, absolutely.
When I was an impressionable kid. Sometimes what happens for me with that is that I run the other way completely if it's not working for me. And so I need to go back and really start to appreciate. I mean, I watched the film we talked about.
Well, you're a kid. You know? Fuck, you're not going to be into the Bee Gees.
No, but I, of course not. But, you know, but you sometimes just kind of keep things under wraps, you know?
Oh, interesting.
And
see,
I think there's, you know, some unwrapping that could be done there just to appreciate
it. I like them, yeah.
Because the doc did kind of pique some interest, you know, in going back and spending some time. But I'm not surprised that great singers want to be involved with anything Brothers Gibb, you know?
Here's the list, but most of them, you know, I'm not into.
Right.
But Brandi Carlile, Jason Isbell, who I am into. He's a really talented country guy. Sheryl Crow, Alison Krauss, Little Big Town, Dolly Parton, Olivia Newton-John. They dusted her off for this. but again, I don't care about that. I just saw Jay's name and got excited. That's all.
I think they sold her black leather jacket from Greece for like, I don't know, some exorbitant amount
of
money.
At some auction or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
Really?
I would have wanted the pants. Now, I would have bought the pants. Let's see. Again, impressionable kid at that time.
Oh, my
That's
God.
That's all I stared at. Yeah.
I like how they're in high school.
Yeah, right.
They're fucking 30.
But you watch Welcome Back, Kotter, which I love that show,
Me
right?
Me too, yeah.
And those guys are like, there's no way, you know, but funny.
Who didn't like fucking Baba Barino? Come on.
What? Where? Oh, man.
Epstein's mother.
Yeah, Epstein.
He had a note from his mother all the time or something, right?
It was always so cool to wear the bandana out of the back pocket, dude.
Yeah.
That was cool.
Oh.
Mr. Carter. Mr. Carter.
Oh, I love that show, man.
Yeah. Love it.
Okay, buddy, it's Doc review time once again. I've been looking forward to this. Not only reviewing this doc, but talking about Frank Zappa in general. I'm fucking excited. I'm stoked. I love the guy, and I can't wait.
You're a big Zappa fan there, buddy, are you?
I mean, this is like a...
The mustache.
This is like a gauge right here, this t-shirt. If you have to ask what that is, then, well...
Is that an Atari game controller?
You're not a Zappa fan.
Yeah, exactly.
Because I think there's no, very little middle ground with him. Either you like him or you don't. Like, it's kind of like Rush. There's a lot of these bands where there's no middle ground. I'm a casual Zappa fan.
Right. Yeah.
Not so much.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is a Zappa doc. It's got a 3-disc soundtrack you can listen to on iTunes if you want.
Right.
He died in 93 at 53.
Yeah. Way young.
Whoa, prostate cancer got him, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to throw it to you, man. What impact, if any, did Frank have on you as a young fan of music or whenever? Did he come into your life at all, ever, and what was that impact?
Zero.
Nothing. Like, zero.
Well, I was never a fan of the kind of quirky, corny stuff. I don't know why. Like, even the Beatles, when I had to play Bang Bang Maxwell's Silver Hammer or something like that.
Right.
It just didn't work for me. It had to be in a rare instance where I would have actually heard much about Frank Zappa, especially in my house and the people right. I was hanging with, you know, at a young age.
Right.
Even into my early teens. It just, he wasn't on the radar at all.
Right.
So none.
None. Zero.
Zero.
Interesting. Well, that's going to be cool, because what I find interesting about that is he defies categorization. So like when I first got into him, when I first saw one of his albums, I was young, like when I was into Kiss, like elementary right. school, whatever. Sure. Cousin's Place again.
Right.
He had this album, Overnight Sensation.
Right.
Right? And it's got a weird cover and a bunch of weird images on it.
Is that him solo or with Mothers?
This is still Mothers, right?
Okay, so still Mothers. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I remember seeing it and thinking, oh, that's weird. And that's about as far as that went. But I do remember seeing this album.
Sure.
And then when I first heard him, flash forward way later, I was about 14-ish, like 79, 80 in there.
Yeah.
And me and a buddy are over at his older brother's apartment, right? Mm-hmm. Hanging out and listening to music and smoking weed, the usual.
Right. Girl.
And he had this. He had this bad boy.
Yeah.
I'm like, yeah. I'd heard the name Frank Zappa, I'm assuming, at some point, right. but I'd never listened to him. This album's called Chic Your Booty. So yeah. this came out in 79. So yeah. it's obviously a take on the disco sure. scene and all that sure. stuff, right? And there's the back.
Yeah.
Frank looking cool as fuck. And he had it on. I remember just being really captivated by what I was hearing, because it's just so, I don't want to use the word weird because I just think that's misleading, but it is odd. There's nothing like this. There's no, oh, that sounds like Zappa. No, no. Nobody sounds like this.
I want to just comment on yeah. on this, what you're talking about with sounds.
Yes.
Yes, I didn't grow up appreciating or really even understanding Zappa.
Right.
But later in my life, you go back or find it and give it a listen, right?
Right.
Which I've done. But as recently as this morning.
Yes.
I had Joe's Garage on
yeah.
in the house.
Right.
And my little dog, Leo, who's a Mexican rescue, left the fucking room and stayed in with my daughter. And we all go like, where's Leo? Right? Where's Julio?
Leo wasn't digging it.
And there was frequencies in the instrumentation and everything that's so foreign
to oh, interesting.
What he hears on a daily basis
yeah.
that he thought something was going on.
Something's wrong.
And he left. Yeah. It was really interesting. It was really interesting.
Frank's playing that guitar solo in the key of Z.
The key of Z, baby. It was just about sound, about sonically what this guy.
The dog didn't dig it.
Also entertains.
You know, yeah. Well, yeah. We'll
exactly.
get there.
So I'm just getting into the sound
right.
field he creates.
It was a dog
it's
whistle.
It's a love or hate relationship. Apparently, my dog didn't like it too much. Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, so I hear this, and he says, I mean, this is a long time ago, so I'm yeah, paraphrasing, yeah. of course, but he doesn't like it. He goes, I bought this. I don't dig it, man.
Yeah.
Do you want it? I go, fuck yeah. So that's the album.
That's the one you take with you, great.
Like, it's beat up and shit.
Yeah,
and
whatever.
That's the one.
Yeah, great.
Right? Well, I could not listen to this album enough.
Really, eh?
Oh, man.
Huh.
It just clicked for me. Like, and keep in mind, I'm listening to just basic fucking rock and roll at this time, right?
Mm-hmm.
Van Halen and Kiss and all that usual, Aerosmith, all that usual shit.
Yeah.
But there was something about it, man. What I like about this album, it's one of his more rock ones.
Right.
Like, I like his more right. rock stuff.
Less jazz fusion.
When
weird.
He jazzes out and yeah. orchestrates out,
yeah.
he loses me a bit. I mean, I appreciate it, but I like the more basic, I'm saying basic Frank, there's nothing basic about him, but on his curve, it's more basic rock stuff. But at the same time, there's songs on there that sound like, you know, a 50s ballad or whatever. Mm. Like, I've Been in You. That's a classic.
I know. Yeah, yeah.
And this is the other thing. So yeah. I'm a young teenage boy. These lyrics are fucking hilarious and dirty and all that. And at that same time, I'm discovering stand-up comedy like George Carlin and
right,
Richard
right.
Pryor. And
yeah. I get
and
that
Cheech
connection.
And Chong.
Big time get that connection.
So this just marries these two worlds, and I just can't get enough of it, right?
Yeah.
I mean, the lyrics, when you listen to them now, some are juvenile and misogynistic as hell.
You
and,
think?
But he's usually, if you really listen, he's usually saying something else. Like it's a social commentary or a satire or about something. He's saying something usually of importance.
If he was a geeky, quirky kid that was putting this music out, I get why people would feel the other. But because this guy's highly intelligent.
Yes.
Like it's to a huge fault, which we'll get into, I'm sure.
Yeah.
But it's a sophistication behind it, but it's almost like he predated rap with his derogatory female perspective, because I mean, you listen to some of those records, it's like they're well below the pedestal that he stands on, for sure.
Well, let me give you an example, Bo.
I'm
going to do this throughout.
You like him, but you don't like, what was the band I talked about a while ago?
Buck Cherry.
Yeah.
Yeah, but they're not smart. That is not smart.
But there's the, you know what I mean? Anyways, go on. Yeah.
Oh, I'm not against being provocative and dirty, but it's how you're doing it, right? This is just comedy. Okay, ready? These are the little lyric snippet from I've Been in You.
Okay.
And again, what I love about it, what I think is so funny, if you had it on at a party, in the background, you wouldn't really immediately think this is a dirty song because it sounds like it could be on the soundtrack for American Graffiti.
Sure.
You know, doo-woppy.
Yeah.
So you got to be paying attention.
Yeah,
right?
Sure.
And then you would hear, I've been in you, baby. You've been in me. Ah, little girl, there ain't no time to wash your stinky hand. Go ahead and roll over. I'm going in you again. In you again. See, this is what I'm saying. Uh-huh. So when you're a teenage boy, this is funny. It just is. Now, I don't know where my parents are when I'm listening to this. I don't recall it ever being a problem, so I have no answer there.
Well, he was the poster boy for a lot of women's movements against popular music.
Oh, yes. And here's here's another one from a more rockin' tune, Broken Hearts Are for Assholes.
Right.
Okay, bear with me because I can't help myself.
Okay.
You say you can't live with what you've been through. Well, ladies, you can be an asshole too. Because the whole thing's talking about guys are assholes.
Right.
You can pretend you ain't got one on the bottom of you, but don't fool yourself, girl. It's winking at you. Yeah. That's why I say I'm going to ram it up your poop chute. Now, you hear me say that and you're like, that's ridiculous. I mean, what is good about that? But in the context of 1979, in the context of this album with the music, it does make sense to me. Like, I still listen to it and enjoy it on some level.
I think one song that comes to my mind is Catholic Girls.
Oh, that's coming up.
Because I was raised Catholic, and I was an altar boy and the whole fucking nine yards, right? In the rectory basement, you know what I mean? The lyrics.
Well, the song, the line I remember from that is, with a tongue like a cow, she can make you go wow.
Yeah. Well, I mean, he hasn't stopped. Like Crew Slut? Like, what's that song? Like
Off Joe's too, yeah.
Right?
It's about groupies, right? That's all that is.
Sure. Get in the show, you suck his cock, you get in the show. I mean, this is what he's singing about. But these
don't make a fuss. Just get on the bus.
Get on the bus, exactly right. Exactly.
The other line, take a little ride on the mixer's face.
See. So I guess Zappa shows up, you know, maybe at a party with the odd tune, but how can you listen to the record is hard for me. Like
musically.
I lose interest.
Musically, it's unreal what's going on.
Sure.
That's what you got to focus on. If you don't like the lyrics.
If you like that. Because sometimes, like you said, he gets so outside.
No, but this kind of stuff, this isn't jazz fusion. This is rock, but it's rock on another level.
Yeah.
Like the musicianship is insane.
Well, just like about Catholic Girls, it's like it's got this girls, you know, kind of stuff. And then it goes into this 50s ballad.
It's a contradiction, really.
But you know how that kind of intertwines, and it's almost off-putting, you know, where it's like, this
yeah,
is...
Yeah, see, there you go. So either you connect with it, which I did immediately.
This is it.
Or it's off-putting.
This is
There's
where
There's no
he's
middle
at.
Ground.
Exactly.
There's not a lot of chicks going to these shows, I guarantee it.
Why does it have to be about the chicks, Randy? You're just proving his point.
Good point.
Yeah.
And last but not least, I want to point out a song on Shake Your Booty called Bobby Brown.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey there, people, I'm Bobby Brown. Some say I'm the cutest boy in town. My car is fast, my teeth are shiny. I tell other girls they can kiss my hiney.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like I said, the band, these are A-list fucking people. That's the contradiction, right? The lyrics are goofy, but the music is unreal. So you got Adrian Blue on guitar.
Yeah.
From King Crimson and David Bowie.
Yeah.
Tommy Mars on keys. Peter Wolf on keys. Patrick O'Hearn on bass. Terry Bozzio. He's like in his fucking early 20s on this shit.
Yeah, you love that.
This is my favorite period of Frank. That's
why he was in your top 10 drummers.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's why I'm pointing this out.
Right.
And Ed Mann of percussion. And if you want to see these guys fucking have at her, this DVD right here, Baby Snakes.
Yeah.
It's shot at the Palladium in New York in 77.
Give it to me.
The fucking guitar solo on Muffin Man alone. I mean, it's just fucking unreal.
Okay, we haven't
even
talked about Frank and his guitar, but he is a
SG man.
He's definitely a Gibson SG man, and
yeah,
he's definitely a virtuoso. Like, they talk about it a bit in the doc, which we haven't even started to talk about yet.
We'll get there. Hang in there, kids. We'll get there.
But he talks about it, you know, in the sense that he got this guitar, and he realized that when you go down, it gets pitch changes when you go up, and it immediately made sense to him.
Right.
And this guy, if you even hear him speak or talk about anything, you know that he's on a spectrum. He's definitely on a spectrum.
Oh, this is a smart man, yeah.
A smart man, but also forgets social graces. And so, like,
well, he lives in Zappa land.
Right.
Yeah.
Like, there's,
yeah,
this is not a normal cat.
Absolutely not. Yeah.
You're either going to relate to him and want to be around him, or you're gonna, I can't.
Right.
You know, it's one of,
and a
same
lot
with
of,
his music. Like, yeah, we're comparing him on a personal level and also his music. They both coincide perfectly.
That's an interesting point. A lot of people did. Like, the number of people that have played with him is fucking a mile
sure
long. Yeah.
But in small moderation.
Yeah.
Like, you know, yeah, Mick will show up at his house and they'll talk, or
yeah,
Lennon or whatever.
Yeah.
But I don't think this is a guy that's going to be easy to be around for any length of time.
He suffers no fools, man. It's his way or the highway.
Right.
Yeah.
And you're going to take that for what it is.
But if you want to be the best at your fucking craft, whether it's playing the xylophone or whatever, you want to be with that guy. Because he's going to push the fuck out of you and get out of you what you had no idea you even had in you.
Sure.
That's what's going on there.
But I also think that when you get so close, the blinders are so closed with your own vision, that you forget that a band is a collaborative affair. There's more to music than being so crazy with it.
He's a composer. He wants people to play what he writes. That's it.
Right.
That's
exactly.
It. That's the end
he
of it.
Started as a composer.
Yeah.
Like, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's one of those things where, and it's just so different and crazy.
Yeah.
And there's parts of music that I just need the refined, grounded melody, make me feel something that is not so challenging to fucking deal with.
Well, there's,
you know,
some of that.
And musicians will be the same way. They want to do both.
If you deep dive into his music, there are moments like that. There are moments. Yeah.
But, you know, he had a different vision for things.
Absolutely.
And I think that not only was it a blessing to play with Frank Zappa, but I think it'd be a very big challenge.
You'd have to have thick skin. No question.
Not only that, but
he's not going to go, hey, great job. Like, you either get it right or you don't. I mean, it's that kind of thing.
Yeah, but I think that's how he deals with his whole life. Like, it's all about him.
Oh, yeah.
Like, he's a narcissistic motherfucker for sure. 100% he is. He can't control it.
Yeah.
There's no fucking
Frank's
way he
do
can
it.
Control
Frank's
it,
do.
Right?
Yeah.
No one's controlling. No, yeah. Frank's not even controlling Frank Zappa. Something else is. And it creates this. You know?
Yeah. And I love it.
Right. And there's people that will love it.
So I get that album. Then I go, I got to go back.
Right.
Right? He's got a bunch of fucking albums before
that. Yeah, because this is in the 70s. So we haven't even talked to 60s.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
And so then I get that Overnight Sensation, and it's got I'm the Slime, Dirty Love. These are more, again, more that rock thing.
Right.
And Dynamo Hum. She was buns up kneeling, I was wheeling into dealing. That song. Awesome. And then Apostrophe. Mm. This was a very popular
one. That was a big record, yeah, yeah.
Right? So it's got Don't Eat Yellow Snow,
Yeah.
Watch out where the huskies go. Don't you eat that yellow snow, right? And Cosmic Debris is a great song off here. The line that pops into my head here is, the price of meat has just gone up and your old lady has just gone down. In my life, this album was huge in another way. Just get a little personal. So I did a couple of years as an orderly in a hospital.
Right.
Just between gigs.
Right.
And while you're waiting to do another run to go deliver some shit or whatever.
Yeah.
You sit in this kind of holding room with other orderlies and you hang out and you could listen to tunes and shit.
Right.
So I'm like, really? You can listen to tunes? So I'd fucking bring all sorts of music in there and people were loving it.
Yeah.
So I brought in Frank one day and I'm listening to this, a little Cosmic Debris. See, gauge the temperature of the room.
Right. Yeah.
And this guy pokes his head around the door, who I'd met briefly, but I didn't know him super well. He goes, hey, is that a real poncho or is that a Sears poncho? And that's a line from Cosmic Debris, right?
I gotcha.
I'm like, who's this dude? Because meeting another Zappa fan is a rare thing. It's a rare sighting.
I'm sure it is. I'm sure it is.
That knows on shit on that level, right?
Right.
Flash forward, he's my brother-in-law now.
Ah.
Yeah, it was Ray.
Ray was working.
We bonded over Zappa. He was working maintenance.
I see. Okay.
At the same hospital. Okay,
I gotcha.
Yeah. And he ends up marrying my sister. So if it weren't for Frank Zappa, and I'm not even exaggerating, that would not have happened.
You tell your sister this frequently?
Oh, all the time. You owe me everything in your life.
I can see that coming. Fuck. From
oh,
totally.
Yeah, totally, right?
Yeah.
And on that note, this is awesome. So that classic album series, you know, where they get a guy behind the mixing console and they break down songs and
shit. Right.
Dweezil does it for Apostrophe and Overnight.
Okay.
And I think you should watch this because maybe you'll have a more appreciation for what's going on there, right?
Yeah.
But that's cool. Very cool. Next up for me was Zoot Allures, another kind of more rock-based album. Black Napkins, instrumentals Wicked. Disco Boy, another disco satire thing. That's a great album. And then this one, you already mentioned it? Joe's Garage.
Yeah, yeah.
Acts 1, 2, and 3. This is 2 and 3, but I didn't want to bring all of them.
Right.
So that's that one.
These kind of rock operas, the timing in the 70s, there was these concept albums that...
Yeah.
I think that were really fun for artists to do, you know, and Frank has really no filter and that album is definitely a concept that is weaved throughout the whole thing. But that was definitely a time and you don't hear of those types of projects.
Oh God, no.
Which is too bad because that's a listening experience. Right?
It really is. But now it's all about the single and that's
I know.
This just reminds me. So whether it's Joe's Garage or any of these albums, his body of work is so huge. Like with Frank, as much as I love him, I do cherry pick. Like I don't love every song on Joe's Garage. He goes off and I'm like, fuck, see you later, Frank. But there's always a handful on these albums that I like. Like Catholic Girls, you already mentioned. Why Does It Hurt When I Pee? That's a funny one. Crew Slut. You know what we didn't mention about Crew Slut is Girls, Girls, Girls Tour, Motley would play that song in its entirety just before they came out.
Oh, perfect.
It was awesome. Just fucking cranked. Oh, it's killer. And then this one I really like. So this is, we're into 81 by now. You Are What You Is.
Yeah.
Love this album. So this was the first time Frank did a music video. So for the title track, he did a video, his only one, and it got banned. So he does his first music video. I remember seeing it on the New Music.
Okay.
So they ran it, but they were a little more underground.
Yeah, MTV they were.
Yeah.
Early 81 New Music. Yes, totally.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, they had a guy with a fucking head of lettuce as a head and it's just like, what the fuck? But they had a guy that looked like Ronald Reagan in an electric chair. Yeah, you can't do that.
No. Do you know what you are? You are what you is. You is what you am. Hey, cow, don't make ham. You ain't what you're not.
And that brings me to this. So this is that tour. Torture Never Stops. You get to see a young Steve Vai on this one. This is what you're looking for. So this is recorded again at the Palladium in New York. Loves that venue. In 81, Halloween night again.
Yeah.
And it's fucking wicked. Like Steve Vai. To be that talented at that age.
I get that connection.
Oh, yes.
Big time. Like
Vai fits like a glove in that.
Totally.
Right?
Totally.
Yeah. And he cut his teeth with him, man.
I got to say this about Vai. I love the the forwardness of him where he reached out and just sent Frank a transcribing of one of his songs.
Black page, probably. Some like, brutal fucking...
I can do this.
Yeah.
And I get you. And totally Frank, you know, smitten to that whole connection, hires him, right? And he moves out to LA.
Yeah.
But it was that forwardness and that almost awkward weirdness, because Steve Vai seems to me awkward.
I think most geniuses, they are.
They are.
And that's what I love about them, though. They're not normal. I don't want normal.
No. And I also got the fact that that's a 2-3 year deal and I'm done. This revolving door of people that want to experience it, but
time. I mean, a lot of guys were with him for a long time, but somebody like Steve Vai, he's going to go do his own thing, obviously. Mm-hmm. Fuck. Yeah. I don't have this one with me, but Man from Utopia 83. I want to mention that because there's a couple songs on it. I remember Reed, when he was on, mentioned one of them. Dangerous Kitchen and Jazz Discharge Party Hats. Okay, why I want to mention these. Remember, you know when Yankee Rose, when Vi's doing the the talking guitar,
yeah,
right? It's that, predates that, and it's Steve Vai doing it for an entire song.
Right.
Copying Zappa's every word and syllable for 4 minutes.
Right.
You know how fucking hard that would be to do, to make it sound like, because Zappa's not singing. He's kind of talk singing. Like if I said to you, "Boy, I went to the store."
Yeah.
And then I bought some bread. It's kind of like that. And Steve Vai's going, wah, 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 wah. Like it's really cool and weird.
Some of you might think this is weird. No wonder it's not exactly normal, but what the fuck? So they're snorting it. Hey, it's the 20th century. Whatever you can do to have a good time, let's get on with it, so long as it doesn't cause a murder.
He's always looked at those opportunities to do something interesting. Like, he's known for this, I can't remember the name that they've given this, where he takes guitar solos or riffs from live performances and puts them on the record.
Good one.
And works it around. Like, it's super crafted.
Yeah.
But it's also crafted. It's not.
That's what he does.
Organic. Yeah. It's crafted. So again, another opportunity where things get weird and crazy and interesting and all that. But your brain has to be ready to be crafted like that. You know,
well,
what
that's
I mean?
Not organic, but a live concert is. He does both.
Sure, but he's got that appreciation for that, and it's always been part of his deal.
Sure,
you know, totally.
And as a musician, you got to appreciate the fact that he's on stage conducting the band. They're like, and he's pointing at shit.
They're scared shitless.
Exactly.
Man. They are scared fucking shitless playing with this guy. Yeah, totally.
Keeps them on their toes.
Totally.
Last but not least, and again, I've got way more stuff than this, but these are the ones that, you know, I don't want to go on forever, and these are the ones that come to mind. Them or Us. So that's 84. Mm. You know, a dog in a dress, and you got Frank wearing an oven mitt for no particular reason.
Well...
So you got Stevie Spanking, which is about Steve Vai, of course. Yeah. Baby Take Your Teeth Out. That's a classic.
Classic Frank Zappa.
That's right. And they do Whipping Post, Allman Brothers, on this. And they do a killer job of it. And that brings me to this. So this is that tour live in New York at the Pier, August 84. Does humor belong in music? Like I said, I like his more rock geared stuff. So that's what I focus on. You know, when he does Yellow Shark and this kind of stuff. I mean, I bought it and I appreciated it, but it's not, you know, it's not making me warm and fuzzy where this stuff does.
Yeah.
Right.
And that's, for me, it's sometimes it's like the music, that's what I'm looking for with music, you know, is to make me feel something. And
yeah,
this is more to make me notice something. And typically the way I listen to music is to feel something. And that's why it probably never gravitated to me. We're different people.
You're
totally
moved or you're not. It's not hard. Yeah, exactly. And I am. And I like all the little lyric, verbal things.
You know, they should do this in music school. They should have a class, a theory on Frank Zappa and, you know, where he fits.
The difference to me, and I'm not a fucking rap expert, but I feel like the difference to me is this is all about sense of humor and being light. You don't have to think it's funny, but that's what he's doing. Rap is not. He's not taking these lyrics seriously. He's goofing around, whereas rap... they're not doing that.
I know. I get what you're saying, but I also, this guy is...
he's provoking and having a laugh.
He is, but it's easy to kind of cloak it with, well, it's okay because he's being goofy. But I don't know. You watch the doc, which we have rarely talked about. What we're going to talk about right now, even now is that he comes home with the clap. He's married, got kids, you know, and it's like, wife, deal with it. I got the clap because that's the way I am. And she does. And they get on medication together and, you know,
yeah,
whatever.
She knows what she signed up for.
I get it. But you sign up for it, but this is the kind of the nature of this guy. I mean,
they're both happy, or well, they wouldn't have been married for 50 years, right?
Whatever. You sign up for it, like you say.
Yeah.
But
I love this
the way
guy.
You act that way is he's got issues and he's an asshole. He's a fucking asshole. He's an asshole with his musicians. They said, you know, not even a thank you or whatever. You played great.
You paid
great.
To do a job, yeah.
Right? It's yeah. kind of like this camaraderie that never existed. And they're all on pins and needles fucking walking around this guy. It's like, where's the fun in that? You know?
Well, I think.
I don't know.
Okay, well, let's get into it. And
yeah,
we will.
Sure.
Because
yeah,
I saw both those things from everybody in that movie. Mm-hmm. They just said that, but they also said they loved it.
It wasn't easy to play and be with Frank Zappa, whether you're his wife or in his band.
I would agree with that 100%.
That's what
it
I
wasn't
guess,
easy, but it was also rewarding in a lot of ways.
I agree.
Yeah.
And I think that there was just with the good came the bad.
Yes.
Yeah.
But I think the good outweighed the bad, or you would not be there, and you are there, right? Nobody's got a gun to your head saying you got to play with Frank. You want to play with Frank.
I think to a point.
Okay, let me give you the synopsis. Zappa is Alex Winter's documentary on a singular life and work of Frank Zappa. Touted as the very first all-access documentary on the pioneering artist, Zappa features previously unreleased footage and music from the Zappa archives, while new and archival interviews will paint a rich picture of Zappa's life. So it's a combination of archival stuff and new stuff. So this Alex Winter cat, I don't know if everybody knows who he is, and this didn't hit me when I first heard his name. But I'm like, oh, yeah, right. He's Bill and Bill and Ted.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Interesting.
He's not Keanu.
I always wondered what happened to that dude. You know what I mean?
So he's Bill and Ted, and he was in Lost Boys. He was the blonde-haired guy.
Yeah, yeah.
So after all that.
He had a look, yeah.
Yeah, he got into behind-the-scenes shit. So he's a producer-director cat. Like, he directed Kimmel for a while. Shit like that. Mm. So he's behind this. And Gail, Frank's wife, gave him access to everything. So I saw him on Kimmel talking about it, and he said, remember the Raiders of the Lost Ark at the end where they put the Ark in a box and you just see this fucking warehouse of boxes looking?
Yeah.
Because that's what his fucking archive's like, and they show it.
They show it,
and it's
this guy was meticulous about saving and storing.
Oh, my God. Here's a reel when Clapton came over to jam. He just points at it.
Yeah.
Like, hey, put that on. Let's hear that.
Yeah.
Anyway, Prince would be very much like that, too, I think. I bet his vault's crazy. Like, he never stopped creating. And recording.
Yeah.
So that's going to happen, right? That's why I think he's got something like 62 albums officially released and 53 after his death, because they just keep going through the vault.
And some of these records have like 35, 40 fucking tracks on them. Like, it's the amount of music.
Yeah.
There is a huge.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Huge,
right?
Number of. Yeah. Of compositions. The guy did not stop.
The other interesting tidbit. It was fully funded on Kickstarter. They got $1.2 million. You think Zappa has fans? They got $1.2 million in 30 days. They got 8,000 backers. Coughed up $1.2 million. It took 6 years to make this thing.
I bet. You get the sense that there was some thought put behind this.
Oh, yeah.
It's not an hour-long little doc featurette, you know?
A little over two, and that's what I want.
It's a little over two. So it's not like you felt like you've been cheated. The doc itself, I was looking forward to because I wanted to know a little more, and I never did any deep dive into Frank Zappa.
Right.
So I was a perfect candidate. And they did a nice job.
They did do a good job.
They did do a good job of putting this shit together.
Yeah.
And I almost wish there was more live performances of Vi.
You know what I have to say about that?
Yeah.
Live performances, period.
Yes.
Because if you don't know his music that well, you don't walk away from this appreciating why he was so great in that regard. Would you say that's true? Like, they're
totally.
Not, because I know, but if you're trying to convince somebody how great Zappa is, this doc is not really going to do that on a musical level.
No, because I want to see him performing this stuff and being there and committed to it, because you got to know that there's certain people that go see a Frank Zappa show and want to be there. And there's some people that are going, I don't get it. You want to see the commitment of his level.
Yeah.
more than what we gave us in this documentary.
Yeah.
But they did cover the bases.
Yes.
To some degree, you know.
Well, they focus more on him as a composer than focusing on this rock stuff that I like.
Mm-hmm.
That was the only kind of downside for me.
But I think they have to, because the type of music he creates is a composition.
Right.
More than it is a rock star.
Right. But he is both those things. And I can't think of anybody else who is. I thought it was cool the way it started.
Me too.
I didn't know any of this. See, it's not like I didn't learn anything watching this. I'm not an expert on Zappa. I just know what I like.
Yeah.
But I didn't know that. So he goes to the Czech Republic and they're having a whole change there. The Russians left and they got freedom and he goes there. And what's the quote is? Keep it unique.
Yeah.
Like, don't fuck it up.
Yeah.
Right? And that was cool, the way to start it, I thought. Because that's kind of his thing. Keep it unique.
What was that, one of his last performances, right?
That's right. Yeah. And you could see it in his eyes, right? I'm like, oh, fuck, this is close to the end. You can just see it, right?
Oh, he's fucking smoking like a chimney. And
why stop then?
Now, yeah, exactly.
fuck,
I'm good.
And you know me, I'm just going to randomly fucking say shit. He's composing complicated music before he's even in his 20s. Like, he didn't write a rock song till he was well into his 20s.
Yeah.
I didn't fully realize that. Like, that's crazy, right? That makes a lot of sense when you know what's coming.
There's not many.
Yeah.
You know, where he's at, where you don't see life the same way. I just don't think you can.
And I think that's so cool, right? He sees life differently. That's
completely
right.
Completely differently.
Yeah. That guy that influenced him, Edgard Versice or whatever, that fucking composer that he really liked.
Yeah, yeah.
Everybody else thought it was unlistenable. And he says, I can't believe people don't get this.
Yeah.
Like, it spoke to him, and that's right to your point.
Yeah.
He just hears and sees things in a different way.
Yeah.
Hence Frank Zappa.
Zappa.
Yeah, exactly. Fuck. I mean, you got pop, rock, jazz, fusion, fucking, it's all in a blender.
But it didn't matter. He couldn't give a fucking care of a title
to
it.
He had zero fucks to give. Zero fucks.
Yeah, totally.
He gave zero fucks.
Like you said, he'd never write a fucking hit song if his heart depended on it. You know what I mean? There's no way that's in his wheelhouse.
Well, he had one.
Well, that's his daughter.
And you could tell. God, that photo shoot. Yeah, so we're talking about Valley Girl. For his daughter, he does this thing.
Yeah.
Remember the scene where they're getting a photo shoot? It looks like he just wanted to run out of there as fast as he fucking could. He's just
so bitchin'.
You could see the pain in his eyes.
But it was so painful for all of us at that time that we...
But again, it was a comedy record. That's how that is not supposed to be taken seriously. It's a goof.
But they did, and that's the crazy thing. Fuck.
Another thing is, I don't know if everybody realizes, of course, it's common knowledge in the rock world, is he gave the Alice Cooper band their big break.
Mm-hmm.
The funny story there is, if I'm not mistaken, he said, okay, swing by the house. He lived in Laurel Canyon with all those other musicians. Swing by the house at 7, I'll fucking check your band out. They show up at 7 a.m. Frank's like, what the fuck are you doing here?
Yeah,
I just went to bed. So anyway, he thought, well, these guys are freaks. Let's see what they got. You know, that's how he rolls. And those first couple of Alice Cooper albums are unlistenable in my mind.
Right.
But nobody else was going to touch that band, and he did. So good for Frank, right?
But I think he liked that macabre kind
of. Oh, yeah. Anything weird.
Weird.
Oh, yeah.
You know, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
What I find fascinating about Frank Zappa, no drugs.
Well, this is back to the contradiction thing. So you've got a guy who's a rock star composer, like we said earlier. Mm-hmm. That's a contradiction. You got a guy who wrote... You know, with the Mothers, that early stuff, which I don't like, by the way. I don't like that Mothers of Invention early shit. Does nothing for me till he starts rocking out. He writes that psychedelic kind of stuff and hates hippies and hippie culture.
Yeah.
The drug thing, right? He thinks it's the downfall of society.
See, this is the one of the weirdest for what he does.
But his fans are doing drugs out the yin-yang.
No, but
like he's a walking contradiction. And
totally.
It's interesting,
and
right?
And the jazz thing, you know, because a lot of jazz were heroin junkies. This guy didn't need any of that.
But how does he do that and write this stuff? You could not. I mean, you couldn't do it like he did it if you were fucked up. There is no way.
I don't know.
That vault with all those tapes would be fucking a fraction that size.
Well, I get that. You could always have somebody do it, in which he started to pay Steve Vai to do. Like, you know, right? But you look at Keith Richards, who would create, you know, a lot of music on heroin, no problem.
But that's different.
I'm just saying the drug and the connection of writing a large amount.
But a straight ahead rock and roll song is not.
It's a little easier. I know.
Sure,
I know.
Come on.
But to the point where he's so trippy and so weird and so and yeah. still creates a lot of music, you think you need cocaine or heroin or
Everybody
something.
Everybody assumes, yeah.
Right.
Totally.
This is where it gets weird to me.
Totally, man. The music he had in his head, he wants people to play it. Obviously, he can't play it himself. And that's for him the frustration. They never quite get there for him.
Yeah.
And that's just attaining, he's a perfectionist attaining perfection. So the quote is, I'd rather not have my music played than have someone play it wrong. Like, yeah. I get that being a motivating factor, but at some point, man, you got to sleep at night still. You got to have fun. You still got to have, are you having fun, Frank? That's what I kept wondering. Are you having fun? Like, he said he had no friends at one point. He goes, I love my family and we have a great time together and all that, but I have no friends. I got no time or whatever. And then I just felt sad for him because I just wonder, I don't know, define happy however you want, but I wondered how happy he was generally in life.
What I see from him was that I'm not surprised he has no friends. I mean, you're slightly narcissistic.
I'm sure he knew that.
Slightly an asshole, but I can accept my time with you. You know what I mean? But if you were about 20, 30% more than that, I wouldn't be doing this with you. You know what I'm saying? So this goes
hang
down.
On. Hang on a sec. I gotta, hang on.
Yeah.
Oh, there's two.
Oh, I'll leave one in there just for good measure.
Holy shit. Okay.
Shake it off.
Go ahead.
Shake it off, baby.
I took the daggers out. Okay, go ahead. Yeah. Yes, I hear what you're saying. Yeah.
Right. And that's the whole thing.
But don't think he doesn't know that. He's a tortured soul, is what I think.
But now you're saying that he does know that. And
of course he knows who he is.
I think with people that are that narcissistic, but also special in their own ways.
Yeah.
That their understanding of social interaction and repercussions of such social interactions is not clear to them. They don't understand it.
Do yourself a favor, and I've done this more than once. YouTube, Frank Zappa interview, and you'll go down a rabbit hole. It's just fan-fucking-tastic. At least I think it is. So the level of condescension he has for people.
Yeah.
And sometimes, most of the time, actually, rightly so. These people that are asking him, well, why do you do this and why do you do that? He's like, yeah. Why not? Fuck you, kind of thing.
Yeah.
It's awesome. Yeah. But yeah, there's a level there where, you're going to piss people off and you're not going to have any friends, perhaps, or whatever. Right?
Sure.
You got to lighten up at some fucking point.
Exactly. And I just don't think it was a, sit around the campfire and have a hot dog with dad kind of guy. You know,
he's a workaholic.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Tell me.
Lots of those.
Tell me that. Because of that, the amount that he was around or the type of father he was, and I'm not going to label him as good or bad or anything.
Yeah, there's a lot of musicians that fall into that category.
That's right. There are. His eyes are on the prize all the fucking time.
That's right.
Right?
They are.
All the time.
But I think to get to a level, you don't think fucking Steven Tyler's like that? Of course he is. Being single-minded and I'm the fucking focus, exactly the same.
I can see that. Totally.
Exactly.
That's
the same.
Narcissistic side of it.
That's why he's Steven Tyler. I like too how he would fucking take shots at things that most people would never do. Like the Beatles thing where they copied Sgt. Pepper.
Oh, yeah.
We're only in it for the money. That's what they called it. So they're going to poke that fucking sacred cow or whatever. Mm. Nobody would do that but him.
Yeah.
And I like that. Because, the Beatles are great, but let's not take yourself too seriously. Jab, jab.
Yeah.
And he called McCartney. Remember that
part?
Well,
I think Lennon appreciated it.
He goes, what are you talking about? I don't care what you do.
Yeah.
Kind of thing. Like, because he's a business guy.
Yeah.
Like, he's in touch with that.
Yeah.
Where McCartney's like, you could talk to my fucking business
lawyer.
Manager.
Yeah, exactly. You want to take a photo of you looking like us? That's fine. Whatever.
Whatever.
Talk to my lawyer. Fuck. I got no time for this shit.
I'll be here over here smoking weed. Yeah. He didn't care. I knew it was going to come up. Obviously, the whole PMRC thing. Here's another contradiction.
Yeah.
So he is the perfect guy for that. Dee Snider was awesome as well.
Yeah.
He caught a lot of people off guard because they see this big rocker,
and
twisted
sister
guy.
And they think he's an idiot. Exactly. Yeah. Fuck, and not quite.
Buckle up.
Yeah. Hold my beer, as they say.
Yes, hold my beer. Frank got right into that world, as he should, but none of his stuff was on that list. That's the contradiction there.
Really?
Like the Filthy 15, because they're not listening to Zappa.
Yeah.
He's not on the radio.
Yeah, it's
so
not
they,
popular.
If they cared enough to listen,
it's not popular. Yeah.
So it was Wasp and Motley and Twisted and all these bands.
Yeah.
He wasn't even on that list.
But if they listened to one of his fucking sets of lyrics on one song, it would have been fucking...
But my point is, he could have not gotten involved in that, and that would have been that.
Right.
but being frank, and I'm glad he did. It was awesome what he did there. A bunch of housewives with their fucking hair up in buns.
I'm glad we're past that point in our lives. Well, we are much more liberal thinking now than we were in 1983.
Oh, just looking at these uptight broads. Right. I said broad.
Broad.
See, I'm going to get hate mail for that. We're not that comfortable. But anyway.
Send your emails to Randy at...
They just looked uptight. Hey, Al Gore, how's your sex life?
Yeah, fuck.
I got another quote that I jotted down. We were loud, we were coarse, we were strange. And if anybody in the audience ever gave us any trouble, we'd tell them to fuck off.
Hey, they're doing it for them.
Yes. And like, I think Alice said something like, you know, Frank could have wrote hit songs. Easy.
Yeah.
But he's never going to do that.
Yeah.
Almost to his detriment, right? Like, make some money with something, but he would never sell out or compromise. Well, Valley Girl was the only one
that...
Yeah. So he died at 50, what did I say, 53?
53, yeah.
62 albums.
Yeah.
The Stones, who we both fucking love.
Yeah.
26.
No, I know. No.
And he's not going to give a sweet fuck about what I'm about to say right now. But after he died, he got into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 95.
Yeah.
And in 97, he got the Grammy Lifetime Achievement. If you haven't, try it out. It's not for everybody. Here's the problem. Okay, I'm going to check out some Frank Zappa. You need, and I'm not saying this like I'm some fucking authority at all, but you need somebody who has some experience with it. You're not going to know where to go. And maybe you hit a couple wrong tracks and you're fucking out.
Yeah.
Like I might be able to give you some more straight ahead, not you necessarily, but anybody, some more straight ahead shit that you might wrap your head around. How about Frogs with Dirty Little Lips? See?
Oh, there's so many names of songs here that you're going, really?
Really? I'm just going to keep going. Like there's a country flavored song on this album called Harder Than Your Husband.
Oh, fuck. See? See, but he's
mocking country music. But, it's awesome.
But he stuck to the sexual innuendo and the kind of delittering of the ladies.
Well, you know me. I love sexual innuendo is one of my favorite things. You know that.
Fuck. And that mustache just fucking reeks of it.
Henry just rolls her eyes. Oh, God, why did you say hole in front of Randy?
Yeah, yeah.
He's going to go.
He's gone. He's gone.
That's what she said to another level. Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, are we done?
I think we're good.
Have I franked you out?
Oh, I've been franking myself out a little bit anyways, just to kind of spend some time with good old Frank other than cheap thrills, but yeah.
Yeah, he's a bit of a dick, but the music speaks to me. What can I
say? There it is.
I'm not living with him.
Yeah.
I'm not in his band, but I love his music.
I'm not sucking his cock to get into the show, Randy.
You don't have a tongue like a cow that can make him go wild?
All right, well, this is a good way back into it. Cheers.
Yeah, that was fun, dude. Cheers.
And all you out there that are watching, listening, thanks for that, and looking forward to more of these.
Yes, absolutely.
Better.
Peace out.